I'm Judy Shaw for NYSE Floor Talk. Joining me today is Mike Dowse. He is the CEO of the U.S. Tennis Association. Mike, it is so great to see you. Thank you so much for joining me.
Likewise, Judy. Thank you so much for having me.
Now, very exciting news today. We know that the U.S. Open is returning, but before we dive into that, I wanted to talk to you about the announcement that you made back in April, where you talked about a $50 million financial commitment that you were making towards grassroots tennis. Why was this so important for the U.S. Tennis Association, and why did you make that decision when you did?
Judy, thanks for asking that question, because at the heart of our association as a governing body is to promote and grow the sport of tennis. And as soon as it became evident in mid-March of the effects of the pandemic, we pulled together all the stakeholders in the industry. And probably not surprising, it was at the time, over 85% of tennis clubs were closed at that point. So we knew that club owners and tennis facilities were in dire straits. Teaching pros that support those facilities were in dire straits. And of course, our end consumer, the tennis players, were in a tough place. So we quickly energized around the terms of relief, recovery, and rebuild. And the first thing we needed to do was provide relief to these stakeholders. And through that, we redeployed and reallocated funds within the USTA, as you mentioned, $50 million to help all those stakeholders who were negatively affected by the virus.
So let's talk about the protocols that will be in place for the U.S. Open. I know that there won't be any fans on site for that, of course. But what went into the process to make this decision, and what are some of the implications?
Yeah, so Judy, really maybe to give you some context, you know, back in March, we talked about the pandemic, it was obvious, was affecting the tennis ecosystem. And of course, the U.S. Open was on our radar. So we put a team together, we commissioned a team to start looking at all scenarios, how we might be able to play the U.S. Open, move it, potentially cancel it. And we got a lot of energy around three guiding principles. And the first is, could we conduct this tournament in a safe way that was in the best interest of the health and safety of everyone involved, the players, our staff, and the local community? Our second guiding principle, is it good for tennis? Does it help inspire people to play our sport? And does it fulfill our or support our mission of promoting and growing the sport? And third, does it make financial sense? Can we do this? So we went through that journey. We put together a very top-notch medical advisory group who consulted with us all through this process. We've also talked to our colleagues at other professional leagues and whatnot. And through that, we put a very robust medical protocol in place, took it to Governor Cuomo and the city and state of New York. And as you heard yesterday, they gave us full support to proceed because they have the confidence that we can run this in a safe way.
Oh, yes, I did hear that. That's wonderful. Okay, so you mentioned the Western and Southern Open tournaments that are going to be taking place. Now, that's going to be taking place before the U.S. Open. What are some of the benefits of this addition?
Well, I love storytelling. And when the USTA has been around 130 plus years, when have we been able to say Cincinnati's being played in New York? that just shows you how unusual these times are. But, you know, the thinking behind it, with great collaboration from Western and Southern and the CEO, John Barrett, there, we all knew it was important for these players to get quality match time in before coming back and playing a Grand Slam. We also, so that checked our second principle, is this right for tennis? And on the safety and health and well-being, it's much easier to create one environment where we control some of the variables versus having to move from city to city. So that's when we started to realize the benefits of moving Cincinnati to New York, it really became clear it was the right move to make.
Okay, now I know that there's a lot of work to be done before the U.S. Open. What are you hearing from your stakeholders, and what's next in the process to plan a successful event?
Yeah, well, one of our key stakeholders is Serena Williams, and as you know, Serena announced today she's excited to play the tournament. I can tell you anecdotally, you know, my phone has been lighting up with people with excitement. We represent 17 sections around the United States and hundreds of thousands of USTA members and millions of tennis players. And we can feel the energy. People are excited this is happening. So now we move into really fine-tuning it and reimagining everything we can do to present a great product. So we're going to work closely with our broadcast partners. You know, we say there's no fans, but we mean there's no fans on site. There's still millions of fans around the world. And how do we engage them in ways that they can never experienced the U.S. Open or the Western and Southern Open in the past. So I think we have a whiteboard to figure this out, and that's the journey we're pivoting towards now.
Okay, and Mike, finally, when all is said and done, how will you define, or how do you define, a successful U.S. Open?
Well, it starts with the health and well-being of everyone, but secondly, to me, it's all about inspiring people to play tennis, especially juniors and kids. So if we get people off the couch, particularly kids who are inactive, and expose them to what I feel is the greatest sport in the world. It's a gift of a lifetime we can give them. And if by hosting this tournament we do that, motivate a new generation of tennis players, then I'll say this was successful and well worth all the effort by the entire team.
Okay, well, Mike, I know I'll be watching, and I'm very excited for this. So I want to wish you the best of luck, and thank you for joining me on NYSE Floor Talk.
Well, thank you, Judy. Have a great day.